Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on the location that you're joining from. First of all, let me thank you all for joining today's webinar on advanced Visualforce development. So let's get started. So if you have been to any of the Salesforce webinars, you might already know what the safe harbor is. But for the first timers, let me explain it is. I will not be making any forward-looking statements, and all the webinar will talk only about the features that are generally available. But just in case if I make any forward-looking statements, please do not make your buying decisions on the statements that I make today. In a nutshell, that's what safe harbor is. So, and if you need more information, feel free to go to the Salesforce website, and there is a section that talks in detail about this. I am Karthik Vishwanatha. I am a director of development at OpFocus, and we are a Salesforce SI partner specializing in doing the implementations, and we have expertise in sales cloud, service cloud communities, and I'm also a Salesforce MVP. You can follow me on my Twitter handle @ log on to Karthik. Feel free to ask any questions or just say hi. Obviously, I'll not be checking my Twitter now, but I'll definitely get back to you on Twitter or on any other channel that you want to follow me on. Salesforce is social. So Salesforce developers are also social. So on all the different social networks, Salesforce is present, and make sure that you follow Salesforce on any of the networks or multiple networks that you are on, like on the Facebook or on the Google, on the Twitter, and you'll be getting the latest and greatest news about the things that are happening in and around the development side of the Salesforce. And for your information, this webinar is also recorded, and you'll be getting a recording link with the slides in a week or two. So in case if you wanted to like go back and view the recording, you can definitely do that. I will be covering a variety of advanced topics today. It will be definitely be fast-paced. And if you have any questions, don't wait till the end. Feel free to post your questions to the Q&A panel. With me, I have two other MVPs, Peter and Jitender, who will also be actively monitoring the Q&A panel and answering the questions as it goes. And we'll also do a formal Q&A at the end. And as I said, if there is this webinar is recorded, so I mean, if you miss some part, you can definitely go back and refer to this one. And one final thing is the prerequisites. Since I'm going to talk about the advanced topics in Visualforce, I would expect everyone on the call to have some at least understanding of what Visualforce is and what Apex is, and basic understanding of web technologies like HTML and JavaScript. And if you are not aware of in either of these technologies or any of these, I would suggest you to attend one of the force.com Fridays or go to the developer.salesforce.com and start looking into it before even like being on this webinar. Today's agenda is pretty straightforward. I'll be talking a little bit about the Visualforce lifecycle, and then I'll go into using the JavaScript remoting and the JavaScript methodologies within the Visualforce. And at the end, I'll end my webinar with talking a little bit about the dynamic Visualforce components. So I'll be covering a good breadth of knowledge on the Visualforce, mainly focusing on the JavaScript side. So let's start with the Visualforce lifecycle. In order for you to understand what Visualforce is and to understand the order of execution of the Visualforce, it is very important for us to know how exactly the page's lifecycle is done. So it is basically determined not just by the content of the page. It also determined based on the user's action towards the page. For example, a user can request a page by like clicking a button or like putting a URL on the web page, and that is basically a GET request where the user is requesting the page, and a page is coming from the server and getting painted to the user's like machine. Or a user can also do a postback request. Like a postback request is where a user performs an action, and based on that action, there are some server-side things that happen, and then the user will be getting the response back. And in these cases, the postback generally has a view state involved, where like there is some kind of a way. This is a view state is a way in which like you store store the data that is interacted between the page and the server. I'll go into a detail about it, that in the next slide. That is the Visualforce lifecycle. Let's look at the lifecycle in detail on the GET request and the POSTMAP request. If as the slide is showing, the GET request is a little bit different versus the POSTMAP request. In the GET request, the first thing that happens is it evaluates the constructors and the components. And if there are any custom components on the Visualforce page, like the custom components that are built by a developer, it evaluates the constructors of those custom components and associated custom controllers of those components. And then it evaluates the expressions and the actions on the page. So when I say action on the page, you can define an action on the Apex page tag itself, that actions. So it evaluates all those things and it creates a view state. A view state is, like as I said, it's a way in which the data is basically interacting between the page and the server, and then it sends the HTML that is generated to the browser, and the browser paints the HTML. Postback request is a little different because it needs to send the view state that has been updated on the client side or on the browser, and it needs to be decoded. So it sends that decoded view state to the controller or the backend server, and the server basically performs the same kind of actions where it evaluates the expressions and the method calls, and then it evaluates the actions that are triggered by the postback. For example, if you click on a save button, so you need to have a corresponding save action within the server or in the Apex that needs to be fired. So it evaluates and performs that actions, and it updates the data. If there is a data update that you're doing, it updates the data in the database. And or if there is a redirect that's happening, it redirects the user to a different page. And it sends, if there is no redirect, it sends the updated HTML back to the browser. So that's basically how the Visualforce lifecycle is. And where JavaScript comes in place is when the HTML is sent to the browser. So if there is any JavaScript that you have written, the JavaScript methods or JavaScript functions or any other like frameworks that you're writing, they get executed on the browser because JavaScript is basically a client-side thing. It gets run on the client. So on the browser, it does all the stuff. So why JavaScript? Why do we need JavaScript in the Visualforce? I mean, it is a very standard MVC framework that we have seen till now. Like, it has it sends the request to the server. Server is processing them, sends back the responses. Everything is going on. So this one, JavaScript allows the Visualforce to become the interface you need. This is a really nice quote that I liked. And Joshua Burke, who is a developer evangelist at Salesforce.com, he was the one who put this quote. So I thought I'll just use his one, borrow his quote from. And I think this is absolutely true, because Visualforce is doing all the things the traditional MVC does. But if you wanted to go beyond what Visualforce does, like if you want to build really cool interfaces, if you want to do something really fast, slick, then we need to like bring in this JavaScript technologies or JavaScript frameworks into the Visualforce and give that added fuel or power to it to do things more than what it does. And Salesforce also is aware of that. It knows about all these things. So I think Salesforce came up with this like really cool things that can be done in the JavaScript. And I'm going to talk about those things. Like, the first one is the JavaScript remoting. I'm going to talk in detail about what JavaScript remoting is. I'm also going to talk about the Visualforce remote objects. And if you are not aware, the standard action function and the standard action support that the Visualforce supports by default, behind the scenes, it is also doing the JavaScript actions. Like it creates a JavaScript method that talks to the controller. It all happens behind the scenes, so a user might not be aware of that. He might be thinking that he's just doing everything in like the Visualforce. And if you wanted to go completely REST, use Visualforce just as the container. Salesforce and the community has built so many open source libraries that use the APIs that Salesforce provides. And those, some of those libraries as I mentioned here, like the JS Force, Force CK, Force CS, NG Force, these libraries are integrated into various front-end frameworks, JavaScript frameworks like Angular or Node. Like for example, NG Force, it's a Node-based library that is available. And like and for Angular, there is a separate library. So you, I'm sorry, NG Force is for the Angular, and then I think it's Force.js, it's for the Node-based. But you have a wide variety of libraries that you can use within the Visualforce and talk to the Apex controllers. So let's dive into JavaScript remoting. So why don't I start by giving a simple demo of what JavaScript remoting is. So I have a simple page that I built. It's a contact search. So all I'm doing is I'm doing a search, like entering a name, and it searches and returns me back the contacts that I found. So let's see. So I searched for Tim, and it returned me Tim Bar Grand Hotels. Let's look at the code behind it. This is the code. We have a controller associated with the JavaScript remoting, and then we have a Visualforce page. So let me walk you through the page. If you look at the page, there isn't a lot of HTML content. All the HTML that is present is like this table that is displaying the results back. And there is a on-click event, on-click action. So if you click on the button, it calls the handle button click, which is basically calling the controller's method to search the contact records and return back the contact records. And the way it is defined is you see that we are passing in the search term, which is the search string that I put in the team, and then render results is a callback. So after you get back the results, you need to know what needs to be done. So the render results will basically take the results, and it will create a table with the values in it. So basically, that is what it is doing. So let's go back. So you have if I say that why we need JavaScript remoting, one of the main advantages of JavaScript remoting is it doesn't have a state associated with it. So I talked about view state, and the view state is where like you're passing in the variables. You are basically storing the variables in a state, and you're talking to the controller using the view state. Sometimes one of the biggest disadvantages with the view state is it is slow because you're basically storing all the stuff on the browser, and you're sending it to the server every time you're doing an action. And in order for you to build like really lean, fast, slick user interfaces, if the response times are slow, I mean it doesn't work. So that's when the JavaScript remoting comes into place, where you do all your actions using the remoting, and the remoting doesn't have a state associated to it. That means it is all like in static nature. That means it sends the data to the server, and it gets back the response, and there is no storage that is happening happening on the page. So that is why it's called a stateless. So it is a stateless way to call the Apex from the JavaScript. And if we look at this picture, it says that there are three different things that are happening, things that are needed to build the JavaScript remoting. One is the remote method invocation, the remote method definition, and the response handler. So remote method invocation is how you invoke the JavaScript method. So in our simple example that we have seen, that is on the button click. So I'm clicking a button, it is calling the JavaScript method. And within that method, we are calling a JavaScript remoting method. And the remote method definition is written in the Apex controller. That's where you do your processing or the business logic. So let me go back to the example. And this is the remote method definition where I'm saying public static list contact search customers. that is the method definition where you're searching the customers, and I'm basically searching, taking the customer name, and I'm returning the so-called like the list of contacts with that name. After you do a remote method definition, and you like basically call it, you are returning the response. JavaScript needs to do something with that response, and that is where the remote response handler callback comes in. Callback is where you're basically doing an action after you get back the response from the server. And if you know, JavaScript remoting is asynchronous in nature. What that means is when you do a action, when you basically click on a button, and you're not really waiting for that action to be completed before doing any other things. That means when I click on a button, I'm basically I click on a button, and then I have a callback handler that will process when the response comes back. So I'm not waiting the time between a button click and time between the response coming. I'm basically not waiting for that time. JavaScript can do a lot of other things during that time. In our case, since it's a simple example, you might not notice the thing, but if you wanted to add a spinner, or if you wanted to do something else during the time when you're getting the response, you can do that, and JavaScript is not basically blocking that time. So that's basically what asynchronous is. Since most of the things in JavaScript are asynchronous by nature, JavaScript remoting is also asynchronous, so you're not waiting, and the page performance is much fast and intuitive. And when you define the JavaScript remote method definition, we need to make sure that the remote method is using the annotation at the remote action, and also it is static. So that is, if you don't do that, you'll probably be ending up getting a compile error. So we have seen a simple example of what JavaScript remoting is and how it can be called. So let's look at the features of JavaScript remoting. I basically told all the features right now, but let's see. So the first one is basically the asynchronous. So as I said, it's asynchronous processing, so you don't have to basically wait or block the whole process just for one action to be completed. And this is very useful. This is very useful, and during when you are building a full-fledged application, because you don't want the user interaction to be waiting on something. And you don't have no state required. Basically, you don't have any forms, so you're not required to use any forms in the Visualforce. This eliminates the need to keep any view state. And by not keeping the view state, you're not basically passing or storing the data that the controller is calling. And one of the best things is you basically have a very small footprint of for what the controller is doing, and it is very efficient. And this is specifically, especially if you look at the use case in the mobile development, if you are using mobile phones, it is very useful when you're building something for the mobile. And just because of the asynchronous nature and no state required, it goes into our third feature, that is the fast performance. It is blazing fast or super fast, and it calls the controller in a fast fashion. It returns back the response, and the way it renders, because everything is done on the client side, it is really fast, and it doesn't have to wait for the server to finish any requests or calls. So let's look at another example of where we use the JavaScript remoting in a real life scenario. So I have two different examples. One is a JavaScript remoting data table. So what I did was I prepared this. I used the data tables JS. If you're not familiar with the data tables is open source library where you can basically render any data, any information in a tabular format. So what I'm doing is I built this app that renders accounts in a list view format with a paginated pagination, search, and other things. So you can basically look at the temp entries. Like, you can change the pagination. You can click on the next page, or you can basically do a search, and it returns a response. So if you look at this UI, it is so fast. It is so fast, and I'm doing a search, and I'm going to the next page. You'll not see any lag or anything like loading or anything, because I built everything in the remoting. So let's this is the code where I'm calling the data tables, the Visual Forces controller, that is the data table con, which is a controller, and the controller is basically doing the search. It is taking the request and the object name, and it is doing a search, building the SQL query and doing a search and returning the results back. That is the only thing that the controller is doing. Rest all is done by the front end, like the component or the page, where I get the results back. I use the data tables plugin, and then I format that to display as a tabular format. And this is one of the real life examples where you can integrate the third party libraries in an efficient way into the Visual Force and still have those abilities to talk to the controller and use the features of the controller in the page. And the other example is using a totally different framework, like a Backbone or Angular or React or any other framework that is present, a JavaScript framework that is that you are familiar with, and building a single page applications using those frameworks. And one of the examples that I have for this webinar is a framework that I've used is Angular. And what I did was, so I used the Angular framework and I built this, again, a table that is paginated, and that is basically using JavaScript remoting and Angular function features and displaying the list of accounts. It is also this, it has the same features, like it has the pagination and it does a search, but it is all written in the Angular.js. And the controller is the same, like you have the same controller and you're using this different technologies basically to paint these various styles of pages, or like using various frameworks. So you have seen a couple of examples of JavaScript remoting and what JavaScript remoting is. It doesn't make really sense, like, so the use cases, now you might already know what these use cases are for where we use JavaScript remoting. So you use the JavaScript remoting if you are planning to build a slick and fast user interfaces. That is absolutely right. And if we wanted to integrate with the third-party JavaScript libraries, want to build mobile applications, single-page applications. And if not, if you are a super JavaScript guru and you just wanted to get started with the Visual Force, you can definitely use JavaScript remoting. And there are some non-use cases as well. I spoke about JavaScript remoting, all the advantages. So I'm not advocating JavaScript remoting, but I'm trying to like tell you the features of JavaScript remoting. So there are definitely some non-use cases where you don't want to use JavaScript remoting, and it's like no true one path. And if you think that you can manage the user interfaces, and if you can manage all the things that you're doing on the front end, definitely JavaScript remoting is the way to go. But if you think that you don't want to manage user interfaces, you want the UI to look very much similar to what Salesforce looks like, and if you want to get out of the box functionalities that the standard components provide, like Apex input field, Apex output field, those kind of things, you can still use Visual Force. And it has Visual Force has a tighter control over the objects, the models, the types. So like if you use the input field, it knows that it needs to render based on the type of the field it is. So it has that more tighter control. So if you don't want to lose that tight control, and if you want Salesforce to manage all those things, you can still use Visual Force. So it is like it's a choice that needs to be taken. And then you can also mix and match. You can still use Visual Force and JavaScript remoting. So I spoke for 10-15 minutes on the JavaScript remoting. So let's go into the Visual Force remote objects. JavaScript remoting is a powerful, popular, and efficient method to building the web apps on the Visual Force. And everyone agrees, I think, especially for creating the pages that have like super powerful business logic in the back end. But Visual Force remote objects is also a way in which you can build single page applications. They are not as powerful as JavaScript remoting, but they provide the simplicity that is needed. to build a single page applications that do the basic CRUD operations. For example, like if you just wanted to build a single page application that just like does an create, update, delete, you can do that using the remote objects. Salesforce is doing all the hard work behind the scenes. Like it is creating the proxy objects for you when you define a remote object, like for using the Apex remote object tag or Apex remote object model, and then it is providing us those data access methods that you can use in the JavaScript to do the CRUD operations like create, read, update, or delete, or any of those operations. So behind the scenes, it is a concept very much similar to JavaScript remoting, but Salesforce is doing it for you. So you can focus only on the front end or like the page. So this slide shows you how the proxy objects are created and how the controller. So when I say the controller is the remote object controller that is automatically created when you define an Apex remote object or a remote object model or a field. And it also provides you with these different functions. So let's look at the remote objects example. This is a remote objects a single page application that I built completely on the Visualforce. There is no controller, so it is all built on the front end, and it is basically displaying the list of the contacts, and you can also create a contact or search for the contacts. Oops. Sorry about that. So let's look at the page. There is no controller, so everything is done on the page itself. But I want to show you a few things. The UI is looking really good because I'm using a Bootstrap library, which is the front-end library, like the styling library that is responsive, and I'm just made it pretty. But the main logic that I want to talk about is the way the remote objects are defined. So the one that I highlighted is how we define the remote object model. So the remote object model is nothing but this object name that I wanted to access in the Visualforce. So when I define this one, it creates a proxy object for the contact that can be accessed in the JavaScript. And I can give a shorthand. Basically, shorthand is like an alias. So you define the model, and then you give an alias that can be used in the JavaScript. And I can specify the fields that I wanted to access in the JavaScript. So these are all the fields that I want to access in. As soon as you define this section, this part where you can, in the JavaScript, we can use this and we can basically access all those data access methods that I've shown you. So for example, I'm basically, in order for me to update or create a contact, I'm using the subject model dot cont basically, and then like I'm doing a create or an update. So these are all the data access methods that are provided by the Visualforce remote objects. And if you, I mean, behind the scenes, what basically is happening is when this one is called, it calls a controller behind the scenes, which is not built by us. It calls the controller and updates the contact record. You can also override the standard CRUD operations. For example, if you wanted to do something else, not just like retrieve the contact or update a contact, or if you wanted to process something, there might be use cases in which you want to process something like before creating the contact, you want to do a validation or something. You can override the standard operations by using a syntax where you define, you say on that, you can say create, and then you can tell the class or the controller in which you are basically overriding it, and you can define that in your Apex class on the controller using the @remote action. And you can say public static, and if you wanted to add some logic here, this one it is not just doing anything, it's just insert creating it, but you can add logic in this method to do some processing before actually updating or inserting into the database. So that's basically how you do the remote object override. I already showed you the demo. That's the contact list. So let's look at the comparison. So let's see the comparison between the JavaScript remoting and remote objects and the traditional controller approach. So we know that JavaScript remoting and remote objects, we definitely need a JavaScript experience. And for the traditional controller approach, it's not required or optional. You don't need to know JavaScript. There is no form submission involved. That means there is no view state involved. So you can basically avoid the view state with the remoting and the remote objects. But the traditional controller object, yes, it has a view state. So if you have an Apex form, if you want to use all the standard components, there is a view state that is involved. And remoting, it is the best thing, best when integrating with other libraries. And it can be used to build some complex business logic. Remote objects, not suggested to build complex business logics, but to build the simple pages and simple CRUD operations on like single objects, yes. Traditional control approach is the way to go if you have complex business logic that is present in the Apex and if you wanted to do everything in the Apex. From the performance perspective, obviously remoting anything that uses JavaScript is faster because everything is done on the client side versus on the server side. So I wouldn't consider it a Salesforce presentation without talking about limits. So limits are the essential part of the whole Salesforce ecosystem. And with the JavaScript remoting and Visualforce remoting objects, yes, there are limits. So there is nothing like you can do anything without limits. There are limits. With the JavaScript remoting, there is a maximum timeout on when you do a server call. The default is 30 seconds, but like you can change it up to maximum of 120 seconds. So if you don't get back the response within 120 seconds, it times out. And the response size needs to be a maximum of 15 MB. So if you are trying to send a huge chunk of data from the server to the JavaScript via remoting, and if it is more than 15 MB, you need to look for alternatives. You can batch it, or you can like send the chunks. And with the Visualforce remote objects, also there are limitations. So maximum rows you get like is 100 rows. There is no support for the blob fields. And if you are using a rendered attribute, it won't basically render the model. So on the Apex remote object model, there is an attribute rendered. You need to make sure that is set to true. One of the good things is that the remoting calls or the remote object calls, they are not counted against your API limits. So that is like one of the good things. And yes, all the other Salesforce limits apply to the remoting. Like you still need to make sure that you don't update or insert more than, I think, 10,000 rows or like the transaction limits. All the other limits still apply to the remoting and the Visualforce remoting objects. I talked a lot about JavaScript in the 40 minutes. Now I wanted to switch gears, and I want to talk about a concept that has been there for a while. And I wanted to show you something that can be done via Apex that is so powerful. That is a dynamic visual force components. And if you are not about what a dynamic visual force component is, that in the visual force we have an ability to make a component, prepare a component in the Apex, and then push that component to the Visualforce. When you say that, what exactly that means? That means you can basically build a input text or an output text or an output panel in the Apex. You can like there are classes, standard classes that are available to you to build them in the Apex, and you can basically push them from the Apex to the Visualforce dynamically at the runtime. So that is basically what a dynamic visual force component is. So that means the tag is Apex dynamic component, and the component value is the value that you are building in the Apex controller. So I built this architecture for the dynamic visual force components that will allow us to build these components in a configurable fashion. What that means is I don't know if so. Think of this one as a page builder or an app builder, where you are basically building the page, a Visualforce page or an app, by just like putting in the components that you need via the configuration. So one of the things that for the architecture it uses the concept of the dependency injection, where you define an interface, and then the implementations are done when the components are built. Why don't I show you an example so that you can understand better? So I have a custom object called page. Pages. It's a demo page, a sample page, and then I have a sample some components which are Visualforce components that I attach to this page, like a data table, a map, and I also have some attributes that are tied to that page. So by nature, let's look at the page. So you can see that these Visualforce components that are tied to the page are rendering on this Visualforce page. And when I say that, you can drive these by configuration. So for example, I wanted to delete this component. I'm basically deleting this component. So I have a map component and the data table. So if I go to the page again, I can see only a map and a data table. And if I want to add a new component, I'm just basically adding a component. I want to add a data table. And these are all the attributes of the data table. So when a data table is defined, a data table Visualforce component is defined, it is expecting these attributes to be filled in. So these are all the attributes. So if I say, okay, I want an account, I'll just keep them as it is. So, yeah. So now I have another data table. So if I look at the page now, you see the data table is rendering dynamically. So that means the look of the page is basically defined by the configuration, where basically you are adding the component and it is showing up on the page. You can change the attributes of the component and all. This is basically the use case or the implementation. How the implementation is done is by using an interface. So the interface is called I available for Visualforce. It's a fancy name that I came up with, which is basically like, so if you want the component to be available for the configuration settings or the configuration, the components class need to implement this interface. And this interface has two signatures. Basically, one is get component, which is returning the apex component, apexpages.component, and the get options is basically returning the attributes that the component is expecting. So those are all the two things. So if I look at the implementation for the, data table. So this is the implementation for the data table. I'm saying like it implements this one. So since I'm implementing an interface, I need to make sure that I define those methods. So I am defining the method. So the data table has various attributes like the object name, the field CSV, the class, or if it is searchable or not, and then the table heading. And then the options are basically the options that you see on that page. That is that we are. Let me show you the base. This page, where when you select the data table, these are all the options that are showing up. So that is returned using this get options method. And there is. Let me show. Classes. So what there is only one Visualforce page that is doing this whole thing. So you can basically mix and match with the different components. You can create your own components and then implement the interface, and it is that component is available for you to be presented on the page. So what this Visualforce page is doing is it is basically painting an output panel with all these components that are defined on that object, and it is throwing it onto the page. So and this page are like this controller doesn't need to know until at the runtime what components are available. So at the runtime, it takes it reads those data from the configuration or the objects, and it paints it for the page. So I have this code on GitHub. So if you want to play around, definitely make sure to play around or like do fork my code. But that's basically the dynamic Visualforce page components. So we are almost at the end. So let's wrap up. So what we have learned so far. So we learned about the Visualforce page lifecycle. We did learn about JavaScript remoting use cases and using it in the Visualforce. The remote objects, the comparison, the pros and cons between each feature, and we ended with the Visualforce dynamic components. So I have references. You'll be getting this slide within a week or so. So you'll be getting all these references and the code, everything. You'll be able to access the code as well. If you are not familiar with the Trailhead, this is an interactive way. So Salesforce launched this thing called Trailhead, which is an interactive way of learning the new concepts on the Salesforce platform. And it is always hard to catch up with all the features that Salesforce releases. The Trailhead is a way you can basically learn about the new feature if it comes in. So if you are not familiar, I would suggest you to go ahead and start playing around. Go to the website. Let me see if I can. And it has all these different various paths that you can start with. So if you are a beginner on the admin side, or if you are I'm assuming most of them on this call are like developers with some intermediate skills. So I would suggest like you can go to the developer trail with intermediate, and it will list out all the different modules that you need to do, and you'll be earning badges for the modules that you do with the various you have various challenges that you need to perform to get your badges. So it is pretty cool. I suggest you to go ahead and start looking at the Trailhead. And for the Visualforce, we do have two trails. Basics, I would say, like Visualforce basics in the mobile. I think for most of you, it might be very easy to get those. So make sure that go to Trailhead and earn these two badges. Your feedback is very important to us. Tell us what we did right. Tell us what we did wrong. We'll try to improve in our next upcoming webinars. Feel free to make sure that you do and fill out the survey. So with that, to the Q&A part. So with me, I have Jitendra Zha, who is also a Salesforce MVP, and he has a great blog article, jitendrazha.com, and Peter Noll, who is also a Salesforce MVP, and he also has a excellent blog article, peternoll.com, to help me answer the Q&A questions that came up during the webinar. Jitendra, Peter, hello.
Hey, this is Jitendra.
Hey, guys. So let's start. So let me see. So we want to take on the questions. Jitendra, you want to like?
So one question I have here is like, what is the best way to have a description or image pop up when a value in pick list is selected? So the options here we have is like, we can create an event binder whenever the pick list value would change, execute some JavaScript stuff, and here we can use, there are lots of model plugins available. So one of the plugin we have is like jQuery model plugin. So on the event of pick list change, we can just fire this plugin, and on this plugin we can either show the description or we can show image. So that's how we can achieve this.
Awesome. That's a great answer.
So the next question here is, that's a good question. Why the view state size is very low, and why it's just 135 KB? It seems to be a major failure issue. So my answer here is like, as we know, HTTP protocol is stateless protocol. So whenever we create any Visualforce page and we perform any option, any action like save information or update, to inform server, we need to provide some information to server, and that information is provided in the form of view state. So whenever any information is coming from server, it is serialized to view state, and whenever we post back something, it is deserialized as the Salesforce site. So the question is, why the size is low? As Salesforce is a multi-tenant platform, we don't want tenants to store as much as data on a view state, because directly it impacts Salesforce server. And another performance issue is at browser end as well. If we allow more data to save on view state, browser may not perform very well. And right now we are on the world of mobile and wearables, and we have lots of devices available which may not be very good in terms of memory and capacity. So we have to take care of everything. So I will say that is the reason why we have a view state limit in Salesforce.
Oh, that's a great explanation, Jitendra. I appreciate you answering that one. Thank you.
So one question here is like, what is the difference between the libraries JSForce and ForceJS? So I will say both libraries performs a task like interacting to Salesforce APIs from the JavaScript. Both libraries are developed by the community users, but from the GitHub repository, it seems that JSForce is much popular library as compared to ForceJS, because it provides lots of more option capabilities compared to another. So I will say we cannot say which library is better and which library is not. It all depends on which suits to your situation. So maybe Kartik, you might to take up our next question, that what is the Angular JS and why do we need that?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that question?
Yeah, Kartik. So the next question here is, why, what is the Angular JS library and why do we need that library?
So the Angular JS library is the NG Force. It is also again built by the community. The reason why we need the library is because AngularJS itself is like a framework within itself. So it has its own model view controller patterns that they use. So if you want to build a Visualforce page that is basically a container but still want to use the AngularJS functionality feature set and talk to all the data models like the objects and the other things in the backend using the APIs, so ngForce provides us the set of methods that will make it easier to call the objects or like retrieve the objects or perform actions on the objects like basic CRUD operations on the objects that can be done using the Angular JS language or like the framework itself. So that is why we needed a ngForce library. But it is not a required thing. I mean, if you are using Angular JS, you don't need to use the ngForce library all the times. It is only when you wanted to build a full-fledged Angular application without a controller at all. That is when you use like a library called like ngForce.
Yeah, that's nice explanation, Kartik. So what you're trying to say is like we should not reinvent the wheel. If something is available already, we should go with that.
That's right. That's absolutely right. Yeah.
Yeah. So next question, I will take it up. So the question here says, for the customers with multiple organization, could we create cross-org functionality? That means, can we interact Salesforce with another Salesforce instance using Visualforce page? So the answer for this is absolutely. We can interact with Salesforce with the other Salesforce instance on the in the infrastructure or the architect, I will say Salesforce can interact with any other system which exposes the APIs, either it's a Salesforce, Heroku application or any other application. But again, the problem here would say, not a problem, the difference here would I say authentication. So first we need to authenticate another Salesforce instance so that we can use the REST API of that instance. And for authentication purpose, we may use OAuth, like we have around 6 flows, or if you want, maybe we can go with the name credential. So first we need to connect to the Salesforce, and then we can easily use the REST API of another Salesforce instance from Visualforce page.
Awesome. Thank you, Jitendra, for that response. I think you're absolutely right. So I have another question. It says, is there any limit on data that could be sent between the server and the client? Yes, there is a limit when you're using the JavaScript remoting. That is the 15 MB response size limit. So it's not really a data limit. So like it's not the number of records, it's the size of the response that you are sending in. So it is limited to 15 MB. So if you have like 10,000 records that are taking 15 MB, then you cannot send more than that. Or if you have only 10 records that are taking 15 MB. So, or like if you are sending an attachment that is like huge, you cannot basically send more than that. So that is the limit that Salesforce has in the JavaScript remoting. So if you have anything that you wanted to send it beyond that, make sure you use batching or chunking or some other feature to basically paint them on the page.
Thanks, Karthik. So next question here I see, can we use a data table JS for the multi-language support when we enable the translations? So I will say Salesforce by default supports multi-language capability, and even on Apex page tag, we have an attribute which says language, and there we can specify that this Visualforce page needs to be rendered in which language, which is enabled in Salesforce. But the question about does data table support multi-language? So for that, actually, we need to see the specification of that library, because that is some kind of a third-party library. But as per my knowledge, AngularJS, and there are many libraries which already support the multi-language. But for this library, we need to see their documentation.
Yeah, I think if they do not support, we still need to write code on the page to do all that supporting the multilingual. And it depends on the third-party libraries, because since it is open source, we don't know whether it is supported or not. And it is, if it is widely used and if they do support it, then it is easier, yes. I think they do. From my experience, I think they do support multilanguage, but not all the languages, maybe like four or five.
Okay, and Karthik, maybe you need to, you may want to take up this question. So the question here is like, is there any location where we have list that which open source scripts we should be using for the Salesforce, or just our choice?
I would say it would be just our choice. I think Salesforce by default supports one library. For the APIs, I think it is Force DK library. It is supported by the Salesforce people, but other than that, all the other libraries are supported by the third-party developers. So, like the JS Force is built by some awesome developer from, I don't know, maybe Japan or some other country. And the same way, like NG Force is built in-house, like in US, someone built that NG Force, and there's a Node library. So these are all built by the developers, and they are made open source. The only library that I know of that is built by Salesforce is the Force DK library, and they do updates to it. But again, it is also open source. And there is, I don't know if there is a place where you can find all these libraries. Maybe I would suggest you to go to developer.salesforce.com and start searching there. And again, it's your own choice, depending on the package that you are using, like if you are using Angular or Node, depending on the framework that you are using for the JavaScript, you might choose one versus the other. I think that that helped answering this question.
Yeah, Karthik, that helps. So next question we have. Okay, so the next question here is like, how can we scale around 100K records on Visualforce page?
Okay, you want me to answer that one?
Yeah.
So if you have 100,000 records in the first place, I think Salesforce itself has a limit of 50,000 or 100. Maybe they increased it. You need to do a thing called server-side pagination or a lazy loading. So the concept is basically you are showing up the page that the user needs to see first, and until he clicks on the next page, like he clicks on the page number or a next on that button, you are not getting the next set of records. So that way you're making sure that you're not overloading the client, you're not overloading the 100K records on the client, which makes the page really slow, and I don't think it blows up all the other limits. And you are just making the server call whenever the user is requesting the next page. And it is much faster and much quicker. The example that I have shown you with the data tables, it is doing the server-side pagination. So when you get this documentation in your email, I would suggest you to go and look into that and see how it is being done on the data table. That will help you out. I don't know if you have any other suggestions, Jitendra, on this one.
Yeah, Karthik. So I have a couple of points here. Like, if you want to use a standard state controller that still has like a limit of 10,000 records. So if you're talking about pagination for 100K records, the first I would suggest check back with the requirement. If possible, try to reduce that count, maybe by introducing some filters. Because if we see a lot of websites which have a large data volume, normally let's take an example of Amazon or something like that. If you want to search something, you have lots of filters there. On the basis of that filter, query gets optimized at the server side. Because like Karthik said, getting any records more than 50,000, the chances are very high. I mean, as per my knowledge as well, we cannot get more than 50,000 records. So you have to think through that requirement.
Yeah. Thanks, Jitendra. There's a question. I think there are multiple questions on the API calls. I wanted to confirm that JavaScript remoting and remote objects does not count against your API limits. They still have their own limits, but not the API limits. So if you make a remoting call to the controller, it is not counted as your API limits. Let's take one last question. I think I know we are at the top of the hour. So let's take one last question and then we'll wrap it up. And for the people who did not get their responses, feel free to put it on the Twitter ask it on the developer boards, and we'll actively monitor and we'll try to answer your questions. Jitha, you want to take the last one?
Yeah, Karthik. So the last question here says, where does the Lightning components fits or falls in the framework? So we can use static resources inside Lightning component, and if you want to access any Apex method from the Lightning, we have to use annotation, which is Aura enable Apex. And I will say Aura enable X annotation is almost same as remote action. So and there is also a safe harbor statement here. Salesforce is working on another way that how the Visualforce and the Lightning will be interacting, but we still don't have much idea about it.
Yes, this presentation is primarily focusing on the Visualforce. Lightning is altogether a totally different topic. Lightning is it's a new JavaScript framework that Salesforce came up with. It has its own structure. It has its own type of components. So still Salesforce is working, as Jitendra said. We'll be having another webinar maybe in the upcoming months on the Lightning thing, and we can discuss in more detail about what Lightning is and how we can build applications on Lightning. So I think that's pretty much it. Thank you all for taking time and joining this webinar. I hope you all have a good day. Thank you.